experiences in technology transfer for the past 20 plus years. Well, you are all aware who makes profits in technologies. I don't know whether an R&D institution should really make profits, but the time has come where we need to make, in addition to whatever academic activities we do, we are supposed to start addressing issues and faced by the society or the industry or the area where you are working. And if these issues are addressed in the process, if you are able to develop a novel innovation where you could also reap benefits in terms of monetary benefits and also get the reward to the R&D institution to the, in which you are working. So in this regard, there is a lot of activities that you need to know how you could take this innovation into making it into a profitable technology. So as you are all aware, the research activity that we undertake normally has an objective where you solve a problem. When you solve a problem, you come across different activities where you develop a process, you develop a new product, or you develop something different which is not existing in the available literature or existing elsewhere in the world. So when you develop a new process, so you need to once also acquire what is the knowledge that is going into that development of new processes. This knowledge needs to be protected. If this knowledge is not protected, I'm sure somebody else will steal your knowledge. So in order to safeguard your knowledge, we need to take actions which are supposed to be beneficial to protect your knowledge for a period of time. And when you protect your knowledge, you can also trade that knowledge into making it into a monetary benefit. So let us understand how this process could be done through our organization, NRDC, National Research Development Corporation. Well, National Research Development Corporation is a public sector enterprise which was incorporated way back in 1953 as a Section 25 company. And as of now, under this Companies Act 2013, we are now a Section 8 company with a mandate to promote, develop, and commercialize indigenously developed technologies that are emanating from various R&D institutions, universities, individual innovators, and many stakeholders who are developing technologies. And our core mandate of our organization is technology transfer. In addition to this, whatever activity that is related to technology transfer, like intellectual property management or project consultancies, all these are activities which we specialize as an organization of the nation. And to be very frank, we have a lot of linkages with the R&D institutions, both now in private sector as well as public sectors. And we have about the 5,000 plus industry associations which are working in tandem with NRDC. We are headquartered in Delhi, and we have an outreach office now at Visakhapatnam. We had an office in Bangalore, which was recently wound up due to certain activities of the corporation. We had to consolidate our business activities, so we had to wind up our office in Bangalore. So this is in nutshell about what is the activities of NRDC, our core mandate. Let us go into detail about how we go about doing this process of business development. As I was telling you, we have a mandate for commercializing technologies, that is acquiring technologies from R&D institutions and other stakeholders who develop technologies, and we commercialize them. And we also have another mandate of the Government of India, wherein we need to implement certain promotional programs. So we have two different programs, that is under the Program for Development of Technologies for Commercialization, which is called PDTC, and the Program for Inspiring Inventors and Innovators, which is PIIII. So under these promotional programs, we carry out a lot of activities that are in tandem with the commercialization of technologies. So let us discuss in detail what are the other activities that we perform. This is in a broad spectrum model which we adopt in the process of commercializing technologies. So on the left, you see the sources of technologies. It could be laboratories, it could be universities, corporate R&D, individuals, NGOs. All these are various stakeholders from where we acquire technologies. And in between, you are seeing there is a lot of other activities that we carry out. When analysis approached for technology commercialization, so we basically ask the institution or the innovator to provide us details on the technologies. Okay, so when the details are provided, so we do a technology evaluation. And in parallel, we file IP, intellectual property, like trademarks, design registration, and many other IP tools which we protect. I'm sure Dr. Sahu must have discussed about all the IP tools that we normally use for protecting a technology yesterday. And in a small scale, we also provide funds to innovators for technology development, and also making the know-how document which enables the transfer of smooth transfer of technology, and value additions like market survey, making market intelligence reports, making basic engineering design package reports, that is BEDP, feasibility reports, consultancy services, publicity to lot of organizations about the availability of technologies. So what we do is when we go for publicity, we also discuss with the relevant sectors, industry sectors, where the probable market could be explored. And we also export technologies as well as technical services, whenever we have an expertise in a particular technology which is implemented by our licensee, that experience could be taken forward to exports. So we also export technologies on a turnkey basis, and we give an opportunity to our own licensees who have implemented these technologies to implement the technology elsewhere in the world, wherever there is demand. On the right, you see the industries and entrepreneurs, the users of the technology. So basically, NRDC is a knowledge transfer organization with a very broad objective of commercializing technologies. So let us discuss in detail what are the other, these are some of the network of research institutions with whom we are associated. You name the institution in which we are associated. It could be ICR, it could be CSIR, the Core Board, ICMR, then CCRS, the Ayush Ministry, laboratories that are associated with the Ayush Ministry, CDOT, CDAC, and several agricultural universities. And in fact, even we have tied up with public sector companies like Neyveli Lignite Corporation, BEML, NTPC, NALCO. These are areas where we are also sourcing technologies which they develop and which they do not have a captive consumption of the technologies on their own factory. So we outsource, we take those technologies and try to give it to the other ancillary industries where they could be exploited. So this is a partial list of associations that we have with the country, in the country. And these are the customers and partners to whom we have been providing services. It could be technology commercialization service, or it could be the intellectual property protection services to whom we have been providing to all these customers. So you can see the list is endless, huge list of customers and partners to whom we are associated. So let us discuss in detail about how we transfer the technologies. So whenever a R&D institution or an individual innovator develops a technology, he approaches the our corporation for getting into a collaboration mode. Usually, we enter into a kind of a memorandum of association with the R&D organization for providing the IP protection services as well as technology transfer services. So the first objective is to sign the MOA wherein we outline what would be the role of the R&D organization. We outline what would be the sharing ratio of the revenue that is generated, and what is the kind of legal implications. Everything is outlined in this MOA and made very clear before we enter into collaboration. So all these are discussed in detail, and we obtain the concurrence from both the sides, and then only we proceed for entering into the MOA. Once the MOA is signed, we then start circulating a technology acquisition format to all the scientists who are in the process of developing technologies or who have developed technologies. The technology acquisition format that we circulate is very, very comprehensive, wherein we capture the details of the technology, its feasibility, its economic viability. All these parameters are captured in the technology acquisition format. So it's very elaborate, and we request the scientists to the extent possible, they should fill up this format and provide it to NRDC. This particular format also becomes a sort of a precursor for preparing the technical know-how document when the technology is transferred to the industry or the licensees. So with this information, NRDC does the preliminary assessment in-house for the its commercial potential, as well as we try to do the techno-economic analysis of the technology, so that we would be knowing what would be the exact commercial implication of this particular technology when we release the technology to the market. So the assessment is done in-house, as well as whenever there is no expertise available in-house, we outsource this activity also to outside agencies or to experts who are available elsewhere in the country. And in parallel, we also suggest the activity like taking IP protection in terms of filing a patent, or it could be a design registration if it is a device-related device development. And if it is a very popular product, which the R&D institution may have given a name for it, we ask them to even file a trademark for taking the protection of the popular name that they have given to the product or the process. So all the suitable IP protection measures are carried out in parallel to the assessment of the technology. And technologies which have commercial potential are taken as an assignment to NRDC through an assignment deed. And this assignment deed gives the rights to the to our NRDC to market the technology, and whatever revenue we generate, we would be sharing that revenue as per the standard collaboration agreement we have entered into. Usually with government R&D institutions and government setups, wherever there is a development which we have acquired from the government setup, we share the revenue in the form of 70-30. That is, 70% of whatever revenue we earn, we remit it back to the R&D institution, and 30% is retained as our share of revenue. So in broad, this is the revenue sharing in government institution. And with private entities and private organizations and individual innovators, the revenue sharing is usually in the ratio of 50-50, wherein 50% of the money is remitted back to the institution from where we have acquired the technology. The revenue sharing is actually done once in a year, after we do all the due diligence of the rendition of accounts and all the other activities, the money is remitted back to the R&D institution once in a year. And as I was telling you, there is a value addition that we carry out at our cost using the promotional grants that the Government of India provides. So we conduct market surveys for very high potential technologies that we acquire. Good feedback from the market survey. We go for further value addition in terms of preparing a feasibility study or a basic engineering design. If it is something related to the processes like in biotechnology or pharmaceutical processes or any food-based activity, food product-based activities. These are areas which are amenable for doing basic engineering design. So based on the preliminary data that is available from the laboratory, the extrapolation is done in terms of simulation of the whole process on a software platform like ChemCAD or Visimix, or these are software platforms which we use for carrying out the basic engineering design. The softwares are so advanced that after you stabilize the process on a simulated process and on the software platform, you can start from 10 kg per day to 1000 kgs per day. These are the scaling up that could be done in the software. Once this stabilization happens on the software platform, the entire process can be made into a simple feature where with just a click of a button, you can get the entire specification of the plant, specification of entire raw materials that you use in the process. The entire process can be just made into on a click of a button, you can get the complete design package for the entire process. So much advanced is the process. You can have a look at the process by just Googling. You could go for ChemCAD, which is a very established software that we use. And of course, now we have started outsourcing this activity to our marketing consulting companies, wherein they do the work and give the report to NRDC for consideration. And wherever there is a requirement, we also carry out a detailed project report, which is usually for the banking purpose the licensee requires. So detailed project report is done on a cost basis whenever there is a requirement raised by the licensee to develop this report. This is also outsourced to our market consulting companies. We have established empaneled market consulting companies who do the job work for NRDC. All these activities, market survey, feasibility report, basic engineering design, and the detailed project report, everything is outsourced by NRDC to consulting companies. And in parallel, we also prepare a tech profile of each technology, wherein we provide non-critical information for publication and communicating to the prospective industries. And once this is done, the R&D laboratory gives us clearance on the profiles that we prepare using the information that is provided in the technology acquisition format. Once this clearance is given, then we start circulating this information through our website, through the social platforms, and wherever we participate in exhibitions or in talks like this, we circulate this information. And once this information is disseminated, we start getting the inquiries from the industry. And we start discussing about how the technology could be commercialized by the industry. And of course, the industry will be having a lot of inquiries, a lot of clarifications, doubts, and which needs to be clarified on a routine basis, on a regular basis, unless until he is totally convinced about the project, he will not be taking the license. So a lot of clarifications is done. Usually, sometimes we involve the researcher also in the discussion and providing clarification. And sometimes what happens is some industries would also like to do some kind of a testing of the product. So at that situation, in that situation, we enter into a material transfer agreement or a material transfer evaluation agreement along with the licensee, wherein he provides a token money of maybe 10% or 20% of the license fees. And he assures us that he will come back to NRDC for acquiring the technology. So some kind of a commitment is taken by the by NRDC, so that we usually don't give the product free of cost. So we charge the licensee or the prospective licensee some kind of no cost basis, no profit basis, the cost of the product, which is made by the laboratory and given it to the given to the licensee for doing the evaluation or testing in the fields field conditions. So once the licensee is convinced, so he comes back to us seeking the terms and conditions on which the technology needs to be transferred. So in consultation with the R&D institution, we decide on what could be the probable terms and conditions. And then we, once it is finalized, we take the approval from both the organizations. And then we go ahead in communicating the terms and conditions for the license. So these are the various terms and conditions which we consider for licensing the technologies. We charge an upfront fee of upfront fee, which is called lump sum premium, before we release the technical know-how. This is the money which they have to pay before signing the license agreement with NRDC. So once this is done, we collect the information about the licensees, their business structure. Usually what happens is we don't license our technology to an individual. So the technology that is licensed is usually to a business entity having all the legal sanctity of having GST registration, income tax registration, all the mandatory permissions for operating the factory or businesses, business licenses, which we they usually take from the pollution control board or any other mandatory that is required permissions on licenses that are required. So once only these kind of legal entities can apply for the obtaining the license from NRDC. And in addition to the lump sum premium, we charge a recurring royalty on ex-factory sales price of the product that they will manufacture and sell over a period of 10 years or sometimes 14 years of license. So the ex-factory sales price is calculated based on their manufacturing cost and whatever the profit margin that they add. Maybe they would be adding 10% or 20% profit margin. And after that, all the other activities like sales, the income taxes, GST, transportation, and the publicity material, which the advertisements, all these are added later on. So the expected sale price is basically the manufacturing cost plus their profit margin. Based on this, they declare the expected sales price. Based on that, we take the royalties from them every 6 months. So the activity that the sales that they do from April 1st to September 30th, they will be remitting the royalties during the month of October. And for all sales that they carry out from October 1st to the subsequent year, calendar year, March 31st, the royalties are remitted in the month of April. So biannually, we collect the royalty returns from the licensees. And the licensing activity continues for 10 years. Usually what happens is once we license the technology, the date of signing of agreement, we usually take us 10 years. But in practicality, the validity of the license would actually start from the date of first sales after they do the erection commissioning and manufacturing activity. So the first sale, that is the first bill of their product, is usually taken as the date of start of the license. So that will continue for 10 years from that particular date. Nature of license, usually the technologies that we source from public R&D and private R&D, we give it on a non-exclusive basis. Since the NRDC doesn't encourage monopoly, so we want a healthy competition in the market. So we give the license to multiple companies so that they have a healthy competition, and there is no monopoly established on any particular license that we issue from the corporation. And sometimes limited exclusivity is given wherein the private industry and the R&D institutions together develop a technology. So at that instance, the limited exclusivity of maybe 3 years or 5 years from the date of signing of the agreement is given so that he gets the benefit of the monopoly because he has invested in the development of the technology. And sometimes, very rarely, there is an exclusive license given. For example, we have given a license on Indelible Ink that is manufactured by one of the companies in Mysore Paints. So that is given on an exclusive basis because the government of India and the laboratory which has developed the technology, that is the National Physical Laboratory in Delhi, they have made it very clear that this particular license cannot be given to any third party because it is a very sensitive. In fact, even the Election Commission has given a dictum that NRDC will not license this particular technology to any third party because of the sensitivity involved in the product which we which the licensee manufactures. So the Indelible Ink is the ink which is marked on our index finger during the election process. Okay, this is a very sensitive product, so we have not given this license to anybody, and we have been continuously renewing the license for the past 35-40 years to Mysore Paints. Sometimes demonstration charges are made when the cost of the raw materials are very high, or if there is an insistence by the R&D institution that demonstration charges should be charged from the licensees. So demonstration charges are usually paid directly to the R&D institution by the licensee. So service tax or GST, whichever is applicable on premium and recurring royalties we are collecting from the licensee. Now the GST is about 12% for the technology transfer, and for technical services it is 18%. Like for filing the IPs, we charge about 18% GST. So once the terms and conditions are finalized, a formal offer letter is made to the licensee, wherein we describe what is the situation in which the technology is, depending on the technology readiness level. So the technology is offered, telling that the technology is being offered on as-is-wear basis. So the licensee will not claim that the technology is on a very small scale and he could not implement it later. So based on his confidence at the stage where the technology is, he acquires the technology. So the things are made very clear when we made the offer letter to the licensee, along with the terms and conditions and the bank details of NRDC, everything is provided. And then based on the offer letter, he accepts and fills up the license application form. In the application form, we capture the details of the licensee, his business structure, as I was telling you. It could be a proprietorship, a minimum of a proprietorship, or a partnership, or a limited liability partnership, or it could be a public limited or a private limited company. It could be even an NGO or a society or a cooperative. It could be any business entity wherein they'll be interested in acquiring the technology. So all the relevant enclosures of their business licenses are also collected, and there is an undertaking given by the industry about who will be the signatory on the license agreement and other documents that NRDC provides. All these are captured from in the license application form. Then the licensee makes the payment of the technology to NRDC. Usually it is done on a digital platform. It could be through an NEFT or it could be RTGS. And then we sign the license agreement. The license agreement, what we sign with the licensee is also quite elaborate, wherein we protect the interests of both the laboratory, the corporation, as well as the licensee. And we outline the role of each of the organizations in the license agreement form. License agreement. And then once the agreement is signed, so the licensee gives back the license agreement to NRDC for execution at our end. So in the process, in between, we also request the R&D organization to go ahead and release the technology. The release of the technology usually happens with a demonstration of the technology, hands-on training of the process, and also providing a very detailed technical know-how document, which outlines all the parameters of implementing the technology. So these are the, some of the major parameters that are made into which go into the technical know-how document. So you need to provide the plant layout, specification of plant, machinery, chemicals, probable suppliers, and provide a detailed data on the test trials and all, whatever is being done, whatever has been done on the product, and MSDS for the products and byproducts, and if there is any hazards that usually come in the which are in the process of implementing the project. So all the pollution control measures, the mandatory clearances, and safety clearances, all these clearances need to be elaborated in the know-how document, so that the licensee would be very clear. And when he implements the project on his site, so all these things are covered, and he takes care of all these activities, so that later on he would not be having any problem in making the product and selling the product in the market. So once the licensee establishes the process and the factory in which he manufactures the product, so he pays royalty, as I was telling you, on a biannual basis, as per the license agreement. Usually the royalties, I was telling you, for bulk chemicals or food-related products, the royalties are charged anywhere between 2 to 3%. And if there is a high-value, low-volume product like equipments and devices, so the royalties are usually 5% on the extracted sales price. So the share of lump sum premium and royalties, once they are remitted to the remitted by the industries, will be disbursed after the technology release is confirmed by the laboratory, and once in a year after the rendition of NRDC accounts. So these two are the factors that are considered for releasing the R&D share to the respective R&D institution from where we have acquired the technology. And of course, if we have filed a patent or any other IP protection for the technology, so the R&D institution which has assigned the technology to NRDC, we take care of the annuities also. So we maintain the payment of annuities. Annuities are the renewal fees for maintaining the patent life for the entire 20 years. So that is taken care by NRDC. Whenever the technology is assigned to NRDC. Okay, so this is one issue which we cannot neglect, because if we lose the validity of the patent, so we will also lose the rights of the product or the processes. And if there is some infringement, we would not be able to defend the infringement. So we need to take care. I think Dr. Sahu must have elaborated the activity where the annuities of all the IP tools have to be maintained at any cost to to maintain the validity of those protected inventions or innovations. And of course, now in the past 4 or 5 years, we have started a small activity to assess the impact of our licenses, which we have been giving to the industry. So this is also outsourced now, and we have a very detailed the process wherein we define the scope of work. We collect the data from the very grassroots where the actual product is being used. For example, if it could be a fertilizer, so we ask the market consulting company to go to the users of the fertilizer. It could be a farmer who could be in the very remote place of where he's implementing the using the product. So he will be assessed. He will be interviewed with a questionnaire on how the product is behaving in the field conditions and what is the benefit he has realized by using this particular product and what was the lacuna that he was facing by using something else earlier to adopting this particular product. So all this data is captured, analyzed, and given to NRDC, and we have got excellent results of this, and there is startling revelation of how the technology has behaved over the years of all the technologies that we have licensed in the past. So of course, we have not been able to do for every technology that the corporation has been licensing. So some few important technologies where we have been getting good royalty returns, for those particular technologies, we have been doing this socio-economic impact assessment studies. And the studies are giving us excellent feedback on how the product is performing in the field conditions. So this is the overall strategy on how the commercialization of lab scale technologies happens, right from starting from sourcing, the value addition, the entire activity done by the licensee in taking forward the technology to the level of making the products and selling the product in the market. This is in nutshell how the entire technology behaves. Okay, let me tell you a few case studies. This is case studies in which we have been having good experience in the associations. This is Central Silk Board, which you're all aware, which is very close to your institution. On the way to your institution, in fact, it is in Madiwala, and we have been associated with Central Silk Board since 1995, and the association has been continuing for so many years. And what is surprising is, for a small sector like silk, see the kind of the IPRs that are being generated in the labs that are spread across the country. We have 4 species of silkworms. I think all of you are aware, the mulberry silkworm, which we call the Banarasi silk or the Mysore silk. This is all the mulberry silk. There is a Eri, Tasar, and Muga. They are the wild species of silkworm. All the 4 different species of the silkworms are available in the country, and there are dedicated laboratories under the Silk Board who are working on these silkworms and developing number of technologies. In fact, the 145 IPs that we have filed, we have received more than 300 or 350 applications, and wherein we have scrutinized and scanned them and thoroughly assessed them, and then only we have filed these 145 IPRs since 1995. Okay, out of these 145 IPs, it could be patents, it could be design registration. A few of them are even trademark registrations, and 1 or 2 copyrights also we have filed. But majority of them are patent applications that we have filed. And out of them, I think more than 30 to 35% have been granted patent already. And out of these 145 IPs that we have filed, we have commercialized 48 technologies. And we have concluded more than 126 license agreements as of now across the country, and earned revenue of 2.5 crores from only technology fees that we have received from licensing of sericulture technology, sericulture-based Of course, these technologies are not very high value technologies. They are basically aimed at the inputs that are required. I have a big list of technologies. I will just show you in the subsequent slides. They are not very high value technologies. They are all low value technologies. But the technologies have made a very good impact in the field conditions in the market, and it has improved the silkworm silk production in the country. Since the past 35 to 40 years, these technologies have made a major impact in the silk production in the country. This is one good experience which we have had with the Central Silk Board Association. And we have another case study, another laboratory in Bangalore itself, Indian Institute of Horticulture Research. Recently, they had a field day in their campus wherein they showcased a huge number of technologies in the horticulture sector. For nearly 4 days, there was a mela which they organized. And we signed the MOU during 2009, and due to certain reasons, we had to conclude it in 2016. And we filed five IPRs for them, five patents, in fact. And they had assigned us 8 technologies, and all the 8 technologies got commercialized. And we had, in that period of our association, we licensed to 42 clients, 42 licenses across the country. And we earned a revenue of about 54 lakhs from the lump sum premium. One doubt you would be definitely having is there are 8 technologies assigned and only 5 IPs filed. What about the remaining 3? Do they not have the IP protection? Of course, they do not have the IP protection, but they are actually technical know-how which has been kept as a secret. I think you're all aware there are technologies which are not filed as an IP or taken as a patent or a design registration. But they are kept as a trade secret for a number of years. You have commercial formulations like Coca-Cola, Pepsi, and all these people who have been safeguarding their product formulations for a number of years without filing any IPs. So similarly, there are a few technologies which we also source from the R&D institutions where we do not have the IPs for them, but they are maintained as a trade secret, and we transfer them as a technical know-how to the industry. This is another case study which we would like to share with you participants. So this is an Indian Institute of Spices Research. It is located in Calicut, which is an ICR lab again. We signed the MOU during 2012, and it is ongoing now. And we had a request for filing 4 IPRs. All of them were patents, and we have filed 4 IPRs. And they had assigned us 16 technologies as of now, out of which 6 technologies have been already commercialized. And we issued around 17 licenses across India, and there are several in the pipeline. And we earned a revenue of 32.5 lakhs from technology fees. Of course, now the royalties have started coming from licensing these technologies. You can imagine just with a single spices, the spices is like, for example, turmeric, ginger, pepper. These are the different spices for which a dedicated R&D institution has been established in Calicut. And for that also, there are so many IPRs being filed and so many technologies are being commercialized. So there is a huge potential in every sphere of our activity in the scientific field. In addition to the facilities that we have in our headquarters, we have an office in Vizag where the Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises has jointly awarded us a project called IPFC in Vizag. We had one office in Bangalore that we recently wound up. These are the mandate of the project wherein we are supposed to provide the IP services to the MSMEs in the particular region in which it is awarded, basically to provide IP protection. And of course, in addition to that, we, as a technology transfer organization, we provide services, facilitate collaboration with technical organizations. These are the broad objectives. And what we have done is, since we have had experience with working with all the other sectors, other stakeholders in the country, So we have thrown open this facility to all the other targeted groups, and they have been getting a lot of benefits by this particular IPFC project. In fact, Bangalore also was a role model project, which it was serving for nearly 6 years. And then it was, after the project was closed, we had to close the office. So the major activities that we do is rare earth search. So we have dedicated patent search and analysis tools that we have subscribed for on an annual basis. We have a Questel Orbit that is a search tool, and there is a Innovation Q Plus. We have two search tools which we use for doing all these activities. And we also request Oxford people also, Oxford scientists, to use the facility here and do the patent searches and do all the value additions that patent search actually does. It could be having a landscape or freedom to operate studies. A lot of things can come out of the patent search and analysis to software. So they have provided us the basic facilities of laptop and all the other tools that are required for running this particular project in the region. This is another activity which is actually done by NRDC for technologies that we really cannot license. So what we have done is, on a very competitive mode, we request the development agencies like NGOs and other organizations, even universities and institutions also have been applying for this particular funding program. So on a competitive mode, we request them to apply for this particular activity. It is called Entrepreneurship Development Program in the rural areas, as well as in the, where there is a focus in northeastern states. And this particular activity, we give a funding of up to 4 lakhs for implementing a project. So the basic aim is to develop technologies which are addressing the local problems in the remote areas. For example, utilization of the locally available resources, like your raw material, it could be human capital. It could be anything similar where they do the thorough analysis, a survey of what could be this availability of raw materials, what could be the probable interventions that they could do it for doing some kind of value addition to the raw materials, and how this value-added raw material could be brought to the market. All these activities where there is actually not much of a technology involved. And we support such activities on a grant mode. So the entire money is given as a grant for implementing to the NGOs. And we have been getting good response for this particular activity. This year, we have scrutinized more than 400 applications just to provide support to about 20 organizations. So this is the kind of response that we have got from the entire country, huge response. And it was a huge task, a Herculean task of screening 400 applications and arriving at 20 applications with so much of competition for this particular activity. As I was elaborating earlier, wherever there is a opportunity for our own licensees for exporting the technology, so we give an opportunity for successful technologies which have been implemented by in our licensees, so that if there is an opportunity to set up such a kind of technology elsewhere in the world, so we give the opportunity to our own licensees to do the turnkey business on to different countries wherever there is a potential for implementing similar technologies elsewhere. So this is just to project India as also a source of technology. It's not a very big activity, but we have been trying our best to export technologies and technical services. And to a certain extent, we have very good presence in the African countries. Name the countries like Ghana or Ivory Coast. These are the places where we have already established good relations with their counterparts. Like they have a CSR in Ivory Coast and Ghana. So we have entered into a collaboration mode with them and implemented several projects, taking technologies from our country to those countries and giving training, demonstration. And there is a potential now that even the people who have been trained have started sourcing the technologies from the implementers who have been gone there and established the as a center in the Ivory Coast or in Ghana. These are some of the technology sectors. More or less, we have covered all the sectors in the industry, except probably software. We are almost in all sectors of the industry in which we are handling technologies. Agri, horti, sericulture, food processing, biotechnology, veterinary, animal husbandry, fisheries, all these are areas, and civil engineering, building materials, dairy industry, drugs, pharmaceuticals, electrical, electronics, chemicals, insecticides, instrumentation, mechanical, metallurgy, rural technologies. All these are sectors in which we are participating and providing technologies to the industries. Some of the most popular technologies that we have commercialized, I'm just giving you a few examples on how technologies could be commercialized in different sectors and how successful these products are. So you can see on the right, there is this Amul spray, infant food. And as a small kid, I remember my mother using this particular product for feeding us. And I have seen even this box is still preserved in our house. Way back since 30, 40 years ago, these were very popular technologies which was implemented by the Gujarat Union, which is located in Anand. Gujarat Milk Cooperative Union, which has been very successful in implementing this product, which has been sourced from CFTRI in Mysore. So these are some of the early technologies that NRDC has licensed for us tractors. Indelible Ink, I was telling you, for election purpose. And Cinema Arc Carbon, I'm sure all of you must have seen the earlier projectors that were being used in the cinema halls, wherein the source of the light used to be the carbon arc and softwareites, which were used for as a carbon rods. And when the both the rods strike, there was a bright illumination. And using this illumination, the cinema screens used to be lighted. So now, of course, the technology is obsolete, and the product also has become obsolete. The licensees have stopped manufacturing these products. Of course, but they were very successful for almost 50 years. They have been very successful in implementing these products. Then titanium substrate for insoluble anodes. Beta-naphthol also was one of the major import substitute that the country used to manufacture using our technology. Artificial heart valve, which is being manufactured by TTK Pharma. Mini cement plant, we have more than 100 licensees using this technology. Fosfomidone is another pesticide that is being was licensed way back. Disposable blood bag is one very good successful technology which has almost replaced the entire imported market. Spirulina algae is another a diet supplement which is very popular, which has been taken up by Paris. And in fact, not only in India, they are also exporting outside the country also. Water filter candles, this is one of the most popular technologies which we have licensed in the country. And earlier, the water filters were using only these candles. In fact, even I remember using this particular device in our home for filtering of water. Then silver impregnated graphite contacts. This is one very popular technology which is still being used in the country by the Indian Railways. Then hydrot continuous kiln for manufacturing bricks. Then permanent marking ink, monocrotophos, another product. glucose biosensor. These are different technologies which we have been licensing over the years, and very popular products that are in market. Let me discuss in briefly about few technologies which you will be appreciating. Even small technologies like the ragi mudde that we consume in our home every day. This is also made as an instant ragi mudde mix. I know most of the housewives, they find it difficult to make the ragi mudde, because when they do this mixing in the on the stove, there is a formation of lumps, and this is a sort of a skill is required to make the ragi mudde. So in order to make this easy and user friendly by the housewives, the only thing that the housewife has to do is to mix the flour, the instant ragi mudde flour, with a definite amount of proportion of water, and then just steam it. So it takes the shape of the container, and then you just scoop it out and make balls out of it and start serving. So this is so simple, technology made very simple. And the ragi flour, of course, that is, it's a proprietary process wherein the definite proportion of the different ingredients are mixed, and there is some process involved in it. And then only then this is easy for making into a mix. And this is we have tried to file a patent protection. Of course, the patent was not granted because of its routine nature of the ragi. Not much of a technology is involved, but the technology is available for licensing. And we have already licensed this to two companies in Bangalore itself. This is a ready-to-eat honey pan beda technology, which has been developed by UAS Bangalore. And as you are aware, honey pan beda, people would like to have it in a fresh form. So, but when you require it in a bulk, and when you want it instantaneously, so you would not like to go and buy the pan leaf in the market and bring it home and make all the mixtures. Instead of that, if it is served in a small pouch, you just put it in your mouth and start chewing it. This is the kind of product that has been developed. It is having a good shelf life and shelf life of almost 6 months, and it has started becoming popular now. We have licensed to two companies in Bangalore, one in Mysore. They have also started manufacturing the product, and slowly it should get popularized and released into the market in a big way. Another product from coconut water, as you are aware, in the temples and in large functions, we break a lot of coconuts, and this particular coconut water just spoils that environment in which it is being done. If you go around temples where the coconut is being broken and offered to the deities, so there is a lot of smell coming out, and the pollution control board has been insisting that this particular coconut water has to be utilized for making into a value-added product, and it should not be allowed to go into the drains and where it starts creating pollution and spoiling the environment and also the soil in the region. So the coconut water is harvested in a hygienic manner, and it is pasteurized, and then it is used for growing the nata using a particular organism, microorganism. Nata is nothing but actually an exudate of the microorganism. It is actually very rich in cellulose, and this is a diet supplement which could be consumed by anybody. In fact, now people have been importing the nata from Thailand and other countries, Malaysia and Thailand. But now we have already licensed this to four companies in the country, big companies who have started the manufacturing of nata and started supplying to big chains in the country. In fact, even in the five-star hotels, the fruit salad is topped up with nata. And it is good, having good properties of having rich dietary fibers and prevents the constipation, and it has other benefits, medical benefits for people who consume. And technology has been already granted patent in the country. This is another technology from ragi bread or millet bread. We have licensed this technology also, having good properties of ragi and millet. You're all aware, having good health benefits. Ragi could be used for making the bread. Instead of using the refined wheat flour, you could also use ragi flour for making bread. Because the picture here, what I've given is the brown bread. It's exactly not a ragi bread. I could not get a picture of the ragi bread. I've just put a general picture of bread here. And this is another product, wheat-based snack bar, which is aimed at increasing the performance of the sports persons. And therein there is after consuming this product for a long time and getting acclimatized to this using of the product, the performance of the athletes or the sports persons improves substantially. You are aware, nutrition is also one of the areas where the sports person has to concentrate to get a sustained release of energy and without increasing his pulse and not feeling very tired during the performance. So this particular product, when it is consumed over a period of time, maybe 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. So it's just a pre-game event, snack. The sports person has to consume this and then start the activity of sports. And product gives you satiety, that is, it fills your stomach. But there is not much of a heaviness that you feel when you consume this product. And it gives you a sustained energy without having any impact on your performance. So this is also one of the reasons why our Indian athletes or sports persons are not able to really perform in the international events. So this also could be a precursor product, which could be used for the sports persons. We are scouting for industries who would be interested in this, and let us see how this takes place in the future years to come. Another technology called defatting of groundnuts. Actually, if you are aware, the groundnuts are crushed, only then there is an extraction of the oil. But in this case, the groundnuts are actually not crushed, but you are extracting the oil. Almost 75% of the oil is extracted without actually crushing the nut or making into a powder form. So after the extraction of the oil is made, the shape of the nut remains or is regained back. And you have a nut now which is having low oil content, and you also have a byproduct which is a solvent-free oil. So there are two products which come out of this particular technology. So this is also another technology which we have licensed in Hyderabad. Value-added products from jackfruit. You are all aware, jackfruit has been getting a lot of importance these days, especially in managing the diabetes and other such kind of ailments that human beings face. So this is the list of technologies which we have sourced from US Bangalore, and this technology has already been licensed by NRDC to one firm in Kerala, and they have started manufacturing and even in fact exporting the products to the Gulf countries. So they have very good reach out in the Gulf countries. They have been exporting the products in Gulf countries also. And this is another technology which we have sourced from Neyveli Lignite Corporation. As you, I was telling you, we have good associations with PSUs that have been associated with NRDC. And they have been developing technologies not for their own consumption, but as a corporate social responsibility, they have been developing technologies. And incidentally, this technology was developed by Neyveli Lignite Corporation and assigned to NRDC way back in 2009. And we have started licensing this technology across the country. And we have almost about 9 licenses. Out of the 9 licenses, 4 have already started production. And 5th is also in the verge of starting production by the end of this financial year. By March 31st, even that particular plant also should be ready. So we have about 5 licensees who have already gone into production, and it is a good product wherein it reclaims the soil. Not only benefits the soil, but it reclaims the soil. You are all aware the soil conditions in our country has been deteriorating. The soil health has been really deteriorating due to excessive use of fertilizers and pesticides and other chemicals. A lot of chemicals have been used. The soil health is deteriorating and the production levels of the soils are going down. Productivity is literally stable, made stable here. And there's no chance that we go back into the earlier years where the response, the way the response was given by the high yielding varieties. So there is a need for reclaiming the soil. So this is this particular humic acid or potassium humate that is extracted after the process. It is in the form of a liquid which is sprayed on the foliage. The foliage could be any crop. The response has been tremendous. There is an average increase in yield of 10% to 30% in yield. Yeah, not only yield, there is also additional benefits of the product in terms of getting immunity to the diseases or to pest attacks, and excellent quality of the product. In fact, the response in Gujarat when it is used on pomegranate, and in Madhya Pradesh when it is used on banana, and in Karnataka, all these places where it has been used on banana, the quality of the banana crop has been excellent. The texture that they get of the pomegranate and the banana crop, and in fact even in chilies, has been excellent. And farmers have been by word of mouth spreading this like wildfire. And now it has also started being used on apple crop in Himachal Pradesh and Jammu and Kashmir. So to that extent, the product has been giving excellent results. And I think, in fact, when the product was launched by Professor M.S. Swaminathan in Chennai way back in 2016, what Professor told was, this could be the major impact of this particular product could be that this is going to be a precursor molecule if it is spread in the country for the second green revolution that could happen in the coming years in our country. So such is the kind of impact this particular product could be having in the country on the crop production. Micronutrient foliar spray formulations, we have been sourcing this crop specific foliar spray formulations from different laboratories. We have for mulberry, cardamom, black pepper, ginger, turmeric. Also, we had for the horticulture crops, which were developed by IHR for banana, for citrus, mango, and vegetables also. So these are crop-specific formulations wherein you are all aware there was only focus of the major nutrients of nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus in the earlier years, and there was no focus on actually supplementing the micronutrients, which are also equally essential for crop production. So the studies have been made on the deficiencies of the micronutrients in the prevailing areas where these crops are grown, and based on the deficiencies, the product formulations for each region and crop is being developed and provided to the licensees, and accordingly the licensees prepare the formulations and supply in these regions these micronutrient formulations, which are also used as a foliar sprays. And there's an average increase in yield of 20%. 20% is a huge impact on these crops. So these are good potential technologies which we have been licensing day in and day out. This is another technology wherein you use the rhizosphere bacteria of a particular species, multiply them and use it as a seed coat, which is actually improving the viability of the viability of the seeds, and also keeping quality of the seed also has been extended without any incidence of pest storage. And there has been good response even in terms of yield, 15 to 30% compared to the uncoated seeds. Quite popular in the in Kerala, where they have used it for spice coating of the spices seeds. This is another technology which we have sourced from Annamalai University, seaweed extract. And this is also a molecule, this is also a fertilizer which is used as a foliar spray as well as in the powder form to any crop which can be applied on any crop, and the yields are improving. These are technologies which we have sourced from CCRI, that is Central Coir Research Institute, under the Coir board. So you can imagine these are technologies which are developed using the waste products of the coconut. So coirate is one technology wherein you use the consortium of microorganisms for retting of the coconut husk. So usually in Kerala, backwaters are used for retting of the coconuts. So in this case, the retting happens over a period of 3 to 4 months. But when this particular consortium of microorganisms are used, the retting happens within 3 to 4 weeks. So, and the quality of the fiber that they obtain is also improved substantially when they use this consortium. Pit plus is another culture of microorganism wherein they use it for decomposition of the pit that is that comes out during the extraction of the fiber. And this particular pit plus has been excellent product for making the coir briquettes, wherein they use these briquettes for the culturing and the protected cultivation, especially in the areas where there is very less availability of the space. Like for example, if you want to cultivate the crop in a terrace, or if you want to do it in a polyhouse or a greenhouse, where the conditions are not very suitable in the soil. But if you want to use this particular, you want to grow tomatoes or any other crop in the polyhouse conditions, this could be used as a medium for growing crops also. So this, after the fungal culture is used, there is a degradation of the pith. And then after the degradation happens, along with the small fibers of the coir, they are compacted into a brick form and then exported to different places, or exported to urban areas for using in the terrace garden or in the polyhouse conditions. This is instant lawn, which has been developed by again CCRI, and this is a lawn which can be rollable and transported to any place and instantly laid out. See, if you want to establish a lawn, it takes almost 6 months. And if you use this particular technology, within 3 to 4 weeks, you have a lawn ready. And this is also licensed to several countries in the, several licenses in the country. And we have also exported this technology to the Gulf region. And the Gulf region, there has been excellent response in terms of the implementation of this particular technology. Food sector, we have huge number of technologies which we have sourced from agriculture universities, from CFTRI, from NDRI, from DFRL. There is huge number of technologies. We have more than 300 food technologies which are live and which are ready for licensing. As I was telling you, our association with Silk Board has been very rewarding, and we have huge number of technologies which are which may address to the inputs, or it could be the machines that are used in the post cocoon stage, or in the weaving of the weaving and fabric manufacturing of the silk. All these are different technologies which are being developed by different institutes under the Central Silk Board. These are some of the popular technologies which we have licensed from the Silk Board associated laboratories. This is silk disinfectant, which we usually use it for as a prophylactic measure to prevent diseases from diseases attacking the silkworms during the rearing process. Simple machines are used, low investment, high returns, huge profits have been made by all the licensees who have acquired these technologies. And this is another technology, this is my last slide here. This is another technology which has been developed, invented by one Sri Sadashivaya of Tumkur. He is a person who had no formal education. He only could read Kannada, but he could never communicate or write or do anything in English or any other language. So with his experience over several years working in this area, he has developed this technology. And he was given a WIPO gold medal. And of course, we have an Indian patent also for this particular device. And in addition to that, the recognition happened over the entire world. So this is a technology which has relevance in the developing country. And WIPO recognized the invention, giving him a WIPO gold medal. The gold medal is pure 24 karat gold medal weighing almost around 300 grams. So you can understand the kind of knowledge that could be generated not just by all educated people, even the people who have been working in the area for a very long time using suitable translators or people who are having sound knowledge in the writing of the specifications of the patent or in the description of the inventions. He is able to generate a patent and he has also been awarded. So the criteria here that only an educated or a well-qualified person has to be a patentee is not the criteria. So even a person, layman, with his experience working in that particular area could also be a potential source of becoming a patentee. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And let me conclude my talk by these few words. So NRDC is a source of technologies of latest information that could be available in the country. We have a huge database of technologies that is latest, live, you can name what it is. And the information could be shared with anybody for exploitation. And NRDC is a house for assessment of technology. Commercialized technologies. We provide value addition to technologies. We organize IPR awareness programs. We facilitate the filing of IPs in the country. We also facilitate export of technologies and technical services. And this is it. And let us discuss if there is any questions. Thank you very much, Dr. For giving me this opportunity. Let us hear from your participants.
Meantime, because we are hosting on FDP.
Any questions, Doctor? If the participants would like to interact and seek any questions.
Dear participants, now the session is open for discussion. Dr. Lakshmi Narayan will be with us for another 20 minutes. If you have any clarification or doubts, please unmute yourself and you can ask, or you can put it in the chat box.
Sir, there is one question posted. Does NRDC guide in obtaining DPO CRC COSMO certificate for organic products?
No, I didn't get your question. What is it? Is it there in the chat box?
Yes, it is there in the chat box. You can
view it. Does NRDC guide in obtaining eco cert COSMO certificate for organic products? Guide them, not a problem. Only thing is we will guide you to the organizations where certification is done.
Sir, can you please stop sharing?
Yeah, we can guide.
Your desktop shared.
I've stopped it. Okay.
Sir, I think Dr.
Yeah, I see next question.
Dr. Surendra Gautam is having a query. Sir, you can unmute yourself and talk to sir.
Yeah, I'm unmuted. Okay, go ahead.
Dr. Surendra Gautam, you have raised your hand. You can talk to sir.
Okay, let me answer this question. And does NRDC guide in obtaining EcoCert? Okay, what we suggest is, what is the kind of product that the certification is required? Ms. Aswati, can you hear me?
Which type of product?
Which type of product is?
Sir, it is for organic products like face creams and other things like organic compound. I mean, organic products are coming in the market now, sir.
Yes. Okay. First thing is, if it is a cosmetic product, so you are aware there is a requirement of carrying out some kind of a trial, sir. Okay. Yes. So you need to do the trials in along with the permission that you take from the Drugs and Cosmetics under the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. So you need to take permission from the drug controller, carry out these studies initially with the animal studies and then subsequently with human volunteers. Okay, you need to first take the permission from the drug controller to carry out these studies. The second thing is you need to prove that they are safe. So the toxicological studies need to be done on the skin. I hope you are aware, toxicological studies.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this could be done with the help of ITRC. There is an institute in Lucknow, ITRC, Indian Toxicological Research Institute, which does this toxicological studies. Some amount of payment needs to be done for getting these trials done. Or you could get the protocol and take the permission from the drug controller and you could do it in your own facility if you are able to generate such a kind of facility in your own organization. So you need to understand what is the protocol that is required for doing the toxicological studies. So you need to have an animal cell culture lab where you need to grow the animal cell culture and then use the product on the surface of the animal cell culture once it is grown, then see what is the response, what is the physiological response, metabolic response, and you need to do some kind of a biological studies, biochemical studies to see what is the response in terms of the cells that cell responds in terms of biochemically how it responds. So you need to find out whether there is any safety that component that needs to be incorporated in your product. If there is a drastic response in terms of cells getting killed or getting melanized or any such observations could be happening. So you need to change the formulations accordingly and keep on developing the product. So in terms of organic testing, probably you could approach ITRC again for getting it certified by the ITRC, because you need to generate so much of data if you are actually working on the organic products or any drugs and cosmetics. You know, a lot of data is required. There is a complete requirement of a dossier, and there is a particular pattern in which you need to generate the data. So all this data has to be generated and then only submitted to the drugs and controllers to formally release the product into the market. So take the protocols and start studying it, and start performing the experiments if it is possible to generate in your own facility, or use the help of the organizations which do the actual studies and give you the report. But a lot of money is involved in that activity, so you need to pay almost around 5 lakhs for ITRC for doing the preliminary toxicological studies.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. Sir, is it mandatory to have
toxicological studies
for herbal?
Yeah, for cosmetics, you need to have the toxicological studies, sir.
No, for herbal drug also.
Herbal drug also, yes. Now they have made it mandatory for all products which are to be used on the humans. There is a requirement of the toxicological studies just to safeguard your product. We don't know, there could be some allergic reactions or there could be any other problems that the herbal products could do the damage on the skin of the humans. So it is better to have at least preliminary data that would safeguard your interest in protecting your product if it is released in the market. And in fact, the herbal drugs also may not be, herbal products may not be stable over a period of time. So you need to even generate data on the shelf life and how the product behaves after a certain time when it is kept on the shelf. We don't know how the response happens. So all the data needs to be generated. Only then the product is going to be declared safe for releasing it to the market. So this is now become a mandatory aspect, even though if it is a herbal formulation, so it doesn't matter. But as a scientific organization, let us make it very clear that the products that are being developed by your organization is safe to the humans in all aspects. So it's better to generate the data and submit the data to the drug controller before we release the product into the market.
So one more clarification, do you provide trust areas for the researchers?
I didn't get you, sir.
In case if any faculty wants to start their research, do you suggest ideal domain where they can proceed with the research, and that will lead them towards a startup or entrepreneurship opportunity?
No, if there is only a requirement of an advisory services, that probably NRDC can provide. But if you require any small grant, as I was telling you, we have a promotional activity of the Government of India. Okay. So if there is a small requirement of grant for proving a concept in the field or doing some kind of a prototype, developing a small prototype, so NRDC provides grant. But there is a condition there that the resulting technology has to be assigned to NRDC for commercialization. That is the only requirement that we seek. And grants up to 2 lakhs is given for doing all the small trials that the institution wants or the innovator wants. It could be a field trial.
Again, it's a technology assignment means it's a contract between the inventor and the NRDC, right?
NRDC, yes.
Based on profit sharing equity.
Yes. If it is a private entity, we will have an agreement of 50-50. And if it is a government entity, we will have a sharing ratio of 70-30. So that is a standard requirement, because NRDC would like to scout good technologies and support them. So that's why this small funding is given. Of course, the funding may not be very big, but sometimes it helps the innovator in proving the concept in the field conditions. He may have got very good results in the laboratory conditions, And the in vitro studies or in vivo studies in the laboratory conditions could have been given a good result. But he wants to take it a little bit further, making some more samples and trying it in the field conditions. In that stage, probably NRDC could give a small fillip of maybe up to 2 lakhs we support. And if there is a bigger requirement of, though we don't have much of funds, so up to 10 lakhs we can support. Provided the technology has a proof of concept already established in the laboratory and it has good potential to be picked up by the industry. So in that case, we provide a grant of up to 10 lakhs. But again, these funds are limited in nature. We hardly give 2 or 3 max in a year. And they should have merit in that technology. This is a very competitive fund. So only if there is merit in the technology, we can provide up to 10 lakhs as a grant.
And that is also possible. Mentorship also, no? Where to go and where to do field trial?
Yes. That mentoring can be done on an advisory basis. Once the technology is committed to be assigned to NRDC, we can provide mentoring services on a day-to-day basis if there is a requirement to get the product tested in a particular laboratory. We could guide them to take them to that particular laboratory and find out where are the exact resources or the laboratories or the equipment available for doing the testing or doing trials. All these services can be done, but there is no cost involved in that. Only thing is what we request the organization is to enter into some kind of a collaboration mode, as last time also I had been requesting. That if there is a collaborative agreement between the organization, it would be much easier for us to take forward and give advisory services.
So in your chat box, there are some more questions if you could answer.
More questions, yeah? Okay. Let us see. What is your opinion on traditional food formulations to release into the market? Actually, traditional foods, if they are scientifically prepared, that is, you follow. See, there is a traditional recipe. For example, gulab jamun is a traditional recipe. Okay, if you have done a thorough scientific way of developing the product and manufacturing the product, there is no harm. Let us do anything which is traditional food, backed up with the scientific trials and results. It is good for us to ensure that if these kind of data is available, you will be very sure that there is not going to be any problem once the product is released into the market. Traditional recipes are being done. See, for example, ragi bread or the ragi mudde, what I was telling you, is a traditional product. So if you can do some kind of an intervention to make it instantaneous. Of course, you know, the ragi preparation of the ragi ball is a very tedious process and requires a certain amount of skill by the housewives. So if you can simplify that and make it into a process scientifically validated and with all the data that is available and having the shelf life studies and all that, and you define what is the shelf life based on the data that is available. So traditional foods also can have a good impact in the society. But only thing is, you have seen MTR has been releasing a lot of traditional products. So the instant mango pickle. So there we have licensed the instant mango pickle to MTR way back in maybe 1930s or in 1945 or 46, after the independence was done. Since those years, MTR has been manufacturing instant pickles. So instant pickle is also a traditional food, which we traditionally prepare at home. Pickle is not a very scientifically developed product. It is a traditional food which is developed. And it has been now systematically manufactured in a factory atmosphere. It is possible, sir. I think there is any other question. Yeah, Dr. Suresh, Surendra Gautam, he is not able to. Unmute himself. I think there are no other questions.
Unmute man. Give it time.
Dr. Surendra, you can put your question in the chat box.
Dr. Surendra Gautam, you can try unmuting yourself. We have made a provision for it, or you can chat your question.
Okay, I think Dr. Ravindra has a question. Is it possible to fortify fat soluble vitamins in protein rich milk products? I think it may be possible. I'm not sure. But if you can fortify, and but how do you preserve when it is being pasteurized? Is it before pasteurization or after pasteurization?
After pasteurization, they can immobilize and they can put it into the product.
Into the product. It can be done, but only thing is you will have to give caution to the users that they have to use a milk cooker for boiling the milk. If they use it on a direct tawa or any other product, any other vessel, the vitamins are going to be lost immediately. If they start boiling it using a traditional vessel, the vitamins are going to be lost. So in fact, fortifying that would be a futile exercise. So they have to make it very clear on the packet of the milk that it is being fortified, and they use a proper milk cooker for boiling the milk.
Yes, sir, it's for milk product. So they can directly incorporate it in the immobilized form. Maybe in the form of yogurt, or maybe in the form of cheese.
Yes,
or
it should be directly consumed. Yes, consumed. Yes, without any process, further processes.
Yeah.
It could be done, sir. That is not a problem at all. I think to the permitted levels, the vitamins can be fortified.
Hope all the participants are satisfied with the explanation doctor has given. Hope no more questions. On behalf of Oxford College of Engineering and on behalf of the Department of Biotechnology and on behalf of all the participants who participated in the event and on the behalf of AACTE, I would like to thank Dr. Lakshmi Narayan for his support extended towards us in organizing this event, and wholeheartedly we thank you, sir, for coming over here with your busy schedule and delivering a valuable, informative and elaborate talk on the technology transfer concept, and we'll be looking forward to have you in all the three sessions, so that all the participants who participate in all the three sessions will get benefit out of it. And as a faculty members, we will be having 100 of questions in our mind to start the innovation, and how to continue it and how to convert it into a product. Maybe our faculty members who are participating in it might have noted your number and email ID, and they may be approaching you for any technical assistance. Please be open with us as you are there, and help us in initiating a kind of innovation environment in the institute.
Okay, definitely. Thank you. Namaste. Okay.
And if you know anybody in IRTC.